Our first speaker this evening is Mitchell Gillies. He's studying graphic design. He's really interested in new technology and the cutting edge of culture. So please give him a warm welcome.
Yeah, I'm Mitchell Gillies, graphic design. I originally started off as an illustrator. I'm an HNC analyst at College, and I kind of decided I wanted to change the tack. I really enjoyed thinking of concepts more so than I did enjoy making images. So I dropped out of that and applied for the foundation year at TJ CAD to do graphic design, and I'm finally here. So the system works, obviously. Fourth year is a really interesting time for us in graphic design. We do a lot of projects. We do four to kind of end off at. So the three show will show three projects plus a motion piece. It's an incredibly stressful time in fourth year. It's going to be really enjoyable, but you do have a lot of work to do. At the same time, 6 months is a very long time for working on the same projects for, so a lot of us fill our time with other things. I myself take on a bunch of little weird side projects as the year's gone on, as well as my four main projects, which is a really bad idea. Don't ever do it. Don't take on more work than you have to, especially in fourth year. But I'll show a selection of those just now. I designed and built an gallery as part of the 150-year anniversary of HG Wells. That was a dissected live in front of a 300-person audience, by Dame Sue Luck, which was really cool. I didn't go to it, I was really scared it was going to break, so I avoided the entire thing. I took on a sort of challenge with a friend of mine to try and do one of the DNA debriefs, which are the sort of main ones that we tackled throughout the year. We tried to do it in 72 hours, which you can see. Scraping sleep for 2 weekends. And then we also made the world's rudest Valentine's Day card. I sold amazingly well. I wonder why. And my flatmate myself also put on a fundraising exhibition, which was like sort of music design posters. That was called Mixtape, and that made a lot of money for us going down to the New Blood, which I'll talk about later as well. So those are some sort of side projects I've been involved in, but obviously the main event is the degree show. It can only ever be a snapshot of our practice as graphic designers. We're not building towards a specific thing. We're always doing loads of different things at once, and then kind of ending and anything can go on with them. If you give us a project for 6 months, or you give us a project for a week, we'll still provide you an outcome at the end of it. So at the end of the day, you know, what we're showing is just a little bit of what we can do. And so the first project I'll show you is my submission to the International Society of Typographic Designers. ISTD is a membership organisation that runs for the UK. It basically, if you pass it, you get to have MISTD after your name, which means Member of the International Society of Graphic Designers. The student awards they run have a 30% pass rate, so it's very difficult to pass it, but DJ CAD is the best in the world now after this year. We had 20 submissions and 16 passes, which is amazing. And this one is thankfully a pass. The idea behind it is it's a typographic manifesto. What that means is, my idea was that the worlds of print and the worlds of screen design are often seen as two completely separate things, and my point is that they're both becoming interchangeable. As such, this product itself is augmented reality book, which means if you have a smartphone, you can open the book, look to a certain page, and it will do things in front of you. So it will actually animate and kind of come to life on your screen. And the idea behind that is just that typography and the way in which we interact with the world is increasingly sort of dependent on these devices, these interfaces. Particularly our politics, which is what I go into a lot of in the book, I had to write up a copy. It's a kind of sort of strong visual piece, I think. I really, really enjoyed doing it. It succeeded in passing. I haven't got any photos of the augmentation, you'll have to come and see that at the degree show. Thank you. So that's one of the projects I'll be showing. Another one is a more kind of commercial interpretation of typography. It was an idea that I had for a music venue or a music space that would also sort of wasn't just restricted to nighttime, because I find that a lot of sort of discussion and sort of dialogue with music culture is that it only exists at night in closed off environments. And I wanted something more inclusive and more kind of open during the day. So this idea of this venue called Headroom was that it would be a space for more than just kind of club music, would be a thing that you go to during the day and enjoy music, and then later on it would also be open. And the idea behind the brand was that this logo and this identity could stretch to encompass all these things, so it physically moves and physically exp- expands and contracts to allow for this. So this is two of the projects I'm going to be showing you. Really. Both have typography as a core element. I don't really see myself as being strictly a visual thinker. I'm much more interested in solving problems. Visual just happens to be the way that I show them. So I'm more concerned with strategic thinking, more concerned with problem solving than I am about making things look good. But hopefully it does look good. Please tell me if it doesn't. I'm going to be worried if I have a 4-year degree and I've completely screwed that bit up. But yeah, so what's next for us? We have the degree show, obviously, which is a massive occasion for us. We have invited most of Scotland's, if not all of Scotland's, biggest design studios to come and visit. We're having a sort of industry preview before the main event, where we apply them with views to give us jobs. And then we have New Blood, which I kind of mentioned earlier on, and that's the UK's biggest design expo for students, and it's down in London, and we're fundraising for that just now. So the poster exhibition I mentioned is one of the ways we made money for that. Hopefully we've made enough. I can't remember what the exact sum was. We might have to contribute a bit more savings. And yeah, that's where we are this time. Hope you come enjoy the show. It's been really enjoyable. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Mitchell. Thanks for kicking us off. It's never easy. It's great. Our next presenter is Barry Anson, who's studying art and philosophy, the works of identity and introspection. So please give her a warm welcome.
As John said, my name is Barry Anson, and I study a course which is technically known as art philosophy, however when I arrived, art philosophy and contemporary practices, which is a very easy way of saying a lot of thinking and questioning before I actually see anything. Here's me, he's very reflective. My work is very much crosses over the boundaries as an artist and as a person. So my personal life and my artistic practice crosses over very largely, actually. So a little bit about me. My history is I did a 2-year HND at Fife College, and gave direct entry to art, philosophy, and contemporary practices, APCE, as I will refer to it from here on out. Cuts the time down a bit. So I'm, as along with Mitchell, Martha, and Mary Claire, I'm going to be participating in this year's degree show. Please come and support us. If you like our work, come tell us. If you don't, but yeah. So what do I do as an artist? My work is primarily text-based, photography, collage, and printmaking. So I do a large amount of a lot of things, and my course really helps me to do that. The art philosophy course at Duncan and Jordanstone is very unique. It's the only one in the UK, in Scotland, of its kind. It's one of three in the UK that combine the visual arts with the humanities. So I spend half of my time in the studio being very artsy and edgy, and the rest of the time I sit and be very edgy and superior in a lecture hall with other philosophy students. So this has helped my practice a lot. It's helped me personally as well to think through various problems. So there is a lot of visual problem solving and a lot of sort of personal thinking. My project's very personal. So in order for you to grasp my project, you need to understand a little bit more about me. When I was, just before I turned 16, I was diagnosed with depression. And since then, it's been something that I have continued to live and fight against. So I would say we're quite sort of on the same terms, me and depression, but you know, it's like a buddy, a flatmate that I don't get on very well with. And I really struggled with it for years. I was at the brink of not being here at one point. And you know, with great thanks to my family and my mum sitting right there, I managed to get through it. And it opened a lot of doors for me. I realised that the biggest thing I needed to realise in my life is that I was an imperfect human being. Which sounds like not a very positive thing, but it really is, because it means all that pressure of trying to be perfect, of trying to be the better person, was taken away, and all I needed to do was be a better version of myself. I suffered again. I was re-diagnosed during my college years, and during my third year, last year, I was re-diagnosed. And I really struggled in particular with that third diagnosis. I kind of felt it was something I should have been past. I got through it, I worked hard, I was still here, why am I still struggling? And so I've come to a point where I use my art as a form of mental health advocacy. third year, I decided to, for the first time, dip into my own personal life and use my life as a stimuli to create work. And people came up to me and said, God, you're so brave, you're so brave. I'm not brave, I'm just honest. 1 in 4 people in the UK suffer mental health issues. And in America, the anxiety levels of high school students today are exactly the same as 1950s mental institution. What does that say? That says that there's a lot of problems we are not talking about, not just in Scotland, not just in the UK, not just in Europe, but everywhere throughout the world, and it's something that starts with a really simple conversation, which I hope to embark on through my work. I've got to the point where through my third year project, I found a lot of catharsis through my work. I found a lot of ease in putting myself out there. My art acted as a little bit of a brick wall. So today is quite scary for me because I'm presenting myself and my art. So that's like two really personal parts of myself. So be nice. As you can see, I'm very cheery now, but that, you know, that is something that happens, you know, on its own and with the help of friends and with medical help. I've seen various counselors, psychologists, and as I said, the help and love of my family and support of my peers, that I'm here and that I'm able to talk about my experiences today. And so my work, I realised looking at the start of this year, I was thinking really reflectively, it's my final year, I'm going on to new things. What new things am I going on to? I don't know yet. It's that fear and that excitement that's driving me forward. And this is what this image, to reflect, represents, which you'll see at my degree show. I've been very sneaky, I've been very limited in my PowerPoint, so that you have to come along if you want to see more. So my work, I hope, to engage with the general public by showing this is my reflection of what I go through, this is my everyday, this is my living with depression, which sometimes is me being bubbly and positive like I am today, although on the inside my heart is like, yeah, very nice. But yeah, and then the rest of it obviously is being, you know, it's that quieter moment, that those moments of solitude. And for me, it's a really, really, as I said, really important conversation to have about mental health because, you know, I realised quite quickly I kept it very secret. Because no one had to know because it made me look frail, made me look weak, couldn't cry in front of people. That's all out the window now, I cry all the time. The fact that I'm getting this far without a tear, success. And I felt that the more I talk about it, the less of a secret it became, and the more it wasn't a secret, the less importance that this depression had over me. I mean, there's people who have been through much worse than me, and people are continuing to go through it, and these are the people that I want to extend a hand to and say, do you know what? It's okay to not be okay. And I will be the first person to raise my hand up and say, I'm okay with that. Sorry. A little reminder where you came from. This is a tech transfer print, also known as an acetone print of one of my work. And my transfer prints that I'm presenting in my degree show kind of accumulate very much my day-to-day, so I don't stop thinking, I don't really stop talking either, so you've got that to look forward to. And, you know, the culmination of images that I've gathered through disposable camera and Instax pictures through Fujifilm, and my own photography through digital camera and the phone, has been used to combine images and to write reflections on these texts. And this question here is really important to me. Where do we go from here? Now, it's something that I ask myself every day, and it can be a very big question, it can be a very small question. It can be, we're at the Dundee Art Cafe then, we've had a nice time, hopefully. What next? Do we get dinner? Do we not? It could be, I've just had a bit of a panic attack in my kitchen at 2 a.m. in the morning. What happens now? It could be, I've just finished the most important 5 years of through college and Duncan and Jordanstone of my life, what happens now? And it's a question that I feel constantly needs answered because I think life is not, you don't just go through large changes. Life as one is a very large transitional period. Every single day is a different challenge you need to face. Sometimes it's getting up and realizing you don't quite have enough milk for your wee bits. Sometimes it's having a very, very public breakdown and wondering how do you go back in the next day and represent yourself? And I think there's no shame in that. And that's why I present myself in this way. I've been Barry Anton. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Barry. That was fantastic. Brilliant. Right, so move on to the next slide already. Have I not? Our next speaker is Martha Andrews. Martha's studying interior and environmental design, and she's been looking at hospital environments. So, over to you.
But really it covers a lot more than that. If you come along to Degree Show, you'll see a huge selection of projects from new builds to regeneration of existing buildings to installation design and set design as well. Our course is obviously directed towards spaces and how people use spaces, but also it's all about design thinking and design thinking which can be applied to a lot of different disciplines. So for my final year project, I've been working on a live project at Nine Mills Hospital with ENT surgeon Rodney Mountain, and I've been looking at how to make a happier hospital. So my project's called Headspace, and it reimagines and repurposes a series of rooftop and courtyard spaces around the hospital. It encourages users to take time out from the clinical environment to connect with nature and thereby boost their personal happiness and well-being. I'm going to talk mainly about my research because I want to keep my final designs so you guys can all come to the Degree Show and see them. Okay, so yeah, I've been really interested in the emotional strain of the hospital environment on its users, I'm looking at not just the patient's experience, but all the other people who use the hospital, so the visitors, students, and staff as well, to really understand the people who are using the space and that I'm designing for. I spent a lot of time up at the hospital, and I was really lucky enough to get the opportunity on several occasions to go into theatre with Rod and experience the whole process of operating on a patient. I also spent quite a bit of time on ward with the nurses at the nurses' station, in Rod's clinics with him, meeting some of the patients, and also with the admin staff who are often forgotten about in the bigger picture of the hospital. Really what struck me most from my research was the amount of things kind of going on behind the scenes in the hospital that people almost forget about, and also the number of people involved in every operation and everything that goes on in the hospital, and therefore might be being affected emotionally by the hospital on a daily basis. So this kind of primary research that I did was pretty hard at some points because a lot of Rod's patients are cancer patients, and I mean, being there when people are getting this sort of awful news is obviously quite hard going. But I found it really important to experience this firsthand and to immerse myself in this kind of situation in order to fully like emphasize with the people that I was designing for. From my research, I kind of concluded that maybe making a happier hospital wasn't as kind of obvious as getting rid of negative emotions, because obviously that's quite hard to do in somewhere that has a nature like a hospital. So what I wanted to do is to design spaces for people to have time out from the hospital environment. So they can have headspace and a place to go to channel their emotions and kind of take control of their lives again. Really just looking at how the relationship between happiness and how that can affect everybody's health, and the happiness of patients means they all get better more quickly. The happiness of staff means that they can treat the patients better. The happiness of the managers means they make better budget decisions, you know, everything like that. So one big part of my design process after this initial primary research was a co-design workshop which I held at the hospital. So that was bringing together about 27 users of the hospital. So I had consultants, nurses, managers, students, admin staff, and also members of the community. By this stage, I had like my basic concepts outlined and also had chosen three spaces around the hospital that I was going to develop. So really the idea of this workshop was to identify how these spaces could work in reality by connecting with the people who were going to use them. For the workshop, I designed a sort of design toolkit that people could use, which you can see up there. And that was really because I was trying to get people to think with the head of a designer, who aren't used to thinking like a designer. So I split up the design task into a series of headings and gave them options that they could choose from to just give them the confidence to approach this task, something that they might not be used to doing. So as my project is a live project and it's hopefully at least aspects of it are going to be implemented in the future, primary research has been a really important part of my year. As you can see that my past year has involved a lot more than maybe the kind of typical things that you would think a designer would do. But I've learned so much more than technical drawing and Photoshop skills, things that I can actually take on and apply into all aspects of my life. Healthcare design is something that I probably had really thought twice about before, and I got offered this opportunity. And it's now something that I'm looking to get involved with after I finish, and hopefully as healthcare design becomes implemented more and more. So yeah, come along to the show to see my designs.
Thank you, Martha. I really enjoyed that because it was a short look through, you know, the immersive world of the design process and how involved you actually have to be. And it's one of my favourite parts of the degree show as well, because in environmental and interior design, there's lots of walkthrough models, 3D models, and things literally are jumping off the page at you or off the exhibition space. So do go and check that out at the degree show. Our final speaker this evening is Mary Claire, who works in textile design. And her work is inspired by her grandfather, and she's looking at how textiles can support memory. Please give her a warm welcome.
Hello, I'm Anthea. I don't really know how to follow up with these well thought out speeches when I'm a last minute person. So I study textile design, and we're a class of 32. It's a real mixed bag. We've got knitters, we've got printers, and we've got people like me who are more surface something or others. So what's good about textiles is that you come into these studio spaces and you will find the most creative, mad kind of place where you literally can find anything from fashion, textiles, to curtains and cushions. And although I say to myself, I'm not going to make curtains and cushions, I have ironically made a cushion for my family. I'll get that later. So you will find a print, and you will also find that although a lot of people are commercial designers who are looking to get jobs in the commercial industries, working for companies and designing for them, you also find a lot of people who are more interested in concepts and strategies and in research, which is my favourite field. So, like I said, I'm much more interested in strategy and concept, and while some people have went for projects that are based around florals or construction sites or anything a little bit more abstract, I have went for how to materialise memories into cloth. And by that, what I mean is there are 1 million people, by 2025, there will be 1 million people in the UK estimated to be suffering with a memory disorder such as Alzheimer's dementia. And that's quite close to my heart, and it's quite close to a lot of other people's hearts as well. It affects so many people that I know. My grandfather suffers from that, and he suffers from dementia, and I thought, how can I use my discipline to, so textiles, to aid that life in some way? So every project needs a starting point, and as a textile designer, I'm a very visual person. I like to draw, I like to create flat surfaces, but I try to look at how to create images that stimulate the memory. So what I've kind of just shown you here in a clip is just a collage of texture and photography and the use of white space as well to kind of represent that something kind of is missing. So, like I say, as a test learner, I try and do good, like nice aesthetic things that are aesthetically pleasing. So my initial idea was to create textiles that visually prompt memories. So went to Dundee, of course, we're in here, so I'm looking around the city and I took photographs of all the kind of monumental and culturally significant places here that could prompt memories. McManus is in here, this photographer here. So initially that was my kind of idea. It's going to be a physical thing, it's going to be a visual prompt. And here's some more, so let's do more. So I wanted something that we live in this digital age, it's expanding and it's growing and we all can benefit from this. I'm standing here doing this and we're Facebook Live. But the elderly generation, do they really benefit from the digital age as much as we do? How can I use textiles and technology to really help those people? And in a way that's not hard to use, because technology can be really hard to use. So I started prototyping how I could make a digital interface that was textiles, that was soft, that was comforting, and that really would go across the disciplines and be able to aid their life in some way. So what I have done is I have used Arduino coding and conductive inks to create textile surfaces that when touched, in certain areas of print, they play sounds. And that sound can be anything. These are personalised models, so they can be printed in any imagery, it can be any sounds, it can be completely personalised. So what I immediately done was went around Dundee and took images of doors. Doors are identity, they're the fundamental thing. Your number is something you won't forget, your door number. So that was one of my inspirations. The other inspiration I had was, when you think of nostalgia and you think of memories, you immediately go back to your childhood and you think, oh, I used to play this, or I remember this jingle from this advert for a sweetie. So I also looked at how children and how sounds of childhood and children's laughter and even just jingles from songs or the sound of crackling popping candy in your mouth can take you back to a certain feeling. So some areas of this print have jingles or children skipping songs and that kind of crackling candy in the fizzlers. And the final concept that I've pushed is street names. Dundee street names and the sounds of street and the sounds of the city. So there's, wifey's yelling in the clothes to get in and there's a... And there's dogs barking in the postage to post the mail. So when you touch the street names, you start kind of just the abstract sounds. It's not people's names or anything like that. It's sounds that are you can interpret them any way you want, and that they're open ended. So where you may be taken back to is completely different to where someone else is taken back to. That's just a neural map of Dundee. Sorry. And yeah, just picking out significant places to me. This is from my walk to where I live in my flat at Hot Hill Primary, all the way through to the McManus Gallery where we are today. And that's just my journey in imagery. And that's me. Back in my flat.